everybody, and welcome to the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study. I'm Liz Cohen. I'm the dean at the Institute. Today we mark the Schlesinger Library's 70th anniversary with a symposium on women's history in honor of Gerda Lerner, who was a pioneering force in women's history and who drew on the library's collection in her influential scholarship. We are fortunate that she gave her personal papers to the library, and we are very pleased that her family is here with us today to reflect on her legacy. I'd like to start our program by sketching a brief history of the Schlesinger Library. From the start, the library has exemplified the Radcliffe Institute's current mission to advance and to share knowledge. By collecting manuscripts, books, photographs, oral histories, and much more, our archivists, librarians, and curators have long provided scholars with broad and deep sources for writing the history of American women. And for many years, we have shared explorations in women's history with engaged publics like all of you through exhibits, films, lectures, and symposia. The Schlesinger Library originated with two efforts to preserve the history of American women. In 1943, the Women's Rights Collection was established by a gift from Maud Wood Park, Radcliffe class of 1898, who had led the lobby for passage of the 19th Amendment. Shortly thereafter, Harvard historian Arthur Schlesinger, an early advocate for women's history, joined with Radcliffe President William K. Jordan and historian Mary Ritter Beard to create the Women's Archive. And this was a time when few libraries viewed documenting the experiences of women as a worthy endeavor. These collections opened to the public in 1950. In 1965, the library was renamed in honor of Professor Schlesinger and his wife, Elizabeth Bancroft Schlesinger. By the 1970s, scholars had discovered the Schlesinger's collections. Social historians were eagerly studying what they called history from the bottom up to understand better the experiences of women, minorities, and the working classes. And as second wave feminism ignited in the 1970s, the Schlesinger began collecting materials related to a reborn women's rights movement as it was unfolding. Our collections have played a crucial role in women's history ever since. Pathbreaking scholars such as Eleanor Flexner, Eileen Creditor, Anne Douglas, Anne Ferris Scott, Nancy Cott, and many others have relied on our collections to write the books that define the field. Gerda Lerner used the Schlesinger's collections for one of the earliest anthologies of primary documents in women's history, as did Nancy Cott. And it hasn't stopped. Last year, librarians and archivists welcomed more than 5,000 researchers and students, and our collections have been cited in more than 10,000 books in the last decade alone. Today, we are diversifying our collections so that scholars can write the next chapter of women's history. Our curators are focused on acquiring collections that will help researchers write a more inclusive women's history, documenting in particular the lives of women of color, women from across the economic and political spectrum, and American women acting globally. We are also digitizing our collections so they will become more accessible around the world. And we are pursuing cutting-edge technologies to preserve what are called born digital materials, like emails and websites, to ensure that all these efforts contribute to the next generation of scholarship and the next generation of scholars. We remain committed to awarding grants to visiting researchers, graduate students, and Harvard undergraduates. 70 years ago, librarians and historians at Radcliffe began documenting the lives of American women for a history that was yet to be written. This fall, when this room was filled to standing room only for lectures on topics in women's history by Jill Lepore and Gail Collins, and for a symposium on the 50th anniversary of Betty Friedan's Feminine Mystique, it was clear how valued and how important that history has become. Today, we have the pleasure and the opportunity to reflect on five decades of change in a field that would be unimaginable without the Schlesinger and without the inspiration of Gerda Lerner. Before I turn the podium over to Nancy Cott, I'd like to offer my thanks to our very distinguished guests for joining us today. This really is the all-star team in women's history. And deep thanks as well to Nancy, the Carl and Lily Pforzheimer Foundation Director of the Library, and to Marilyn Dunn, the Library's Executive Director, for their joint leadership of the Schlesinger, and to the Library's dedicated staff for helping to ensure its continued vibrancy. It's now my great pleasure to introduce Nancy Cott, distinguished historian of gender, social movements, and law and citizenship, and one of the preeminent historians of American women. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you so much, Liz. I really want to thank our dean and fellow historian for her generous enthusiasm for this event. And also, let me give thanks right away to the staff of the Radcliffe Institute in the events and in communications departments. I'm very grateful for all they've done to make things run smoothly and publicize our event today. I'm delighted to see you all here. As Liz began to mention, 70 years ago this year, in the midst of a world war, the outcome of which was definitely not yet known, Radcliffe College alumna Maud Wood Park gave her suffrage memorabilia and papers to her alma mater, and the president of Radcliffe College made that gift the beginning of the new women's archives. It was a far-seeing move by Wilbur Jordan, a move stimulated, it seems fair to say, by the wartime demands that had given women access to unprecedented public roles in the labor force, in government, in universities, and in the military. Radcliffe's then immediate solicitation of women's papers and women's groups' records in the late 40s and then in the 1950s built a core collection of materials that are still among some of our most used papers today. So we gathered to mark the 70th anniversary of that origin and equally to honor and celebrate the significance of Gerda Lerner in the field of women's history for which she did so much. I feel there is a strong connection between these two. The founding years of the library and the career of Gerda Lerner are very strongly linked through Mary Ritter Beard's imprint on both. Historian Mary Ritter Beard, who was quite well known in the first half of the 20th century as co-author with her far better known husband, Charles Beard. They co-authored several best-selling texts of US history. Beard, really deserves the name of women's history pioneer. She had founded a project in the 1930s to establish a world center for women's archives. That project fell apart by 1941, but there she was, ready, willing, and able to help Radcliffe College with its women's archives when Wilbur Jordan sought her advice. And she was ready to hand over some of the collections she had already amassed. Mary Beard must be credited as a founding mother of the Schlesinger Library, and she was equally important to Gerda Lerner's career. Lerner hugely admired Mary Beard's efforts, regarded her as a model and forebear, and Lerner, in her own volumes called The Creation of Patriarchy and The Creation of Feminist Consciousness, two different volumes, in these volumes, Gerda Lerner explicitly intended to complete a project of historical recovery that Mary Ritter Beard had envisioned and begun but had never really got underway with. Now, before I say any more by way of introduction, I want to mention that we are very fortunate to have Gerda Lerner's daughter, Stephanie Lerner Lapidus, in the audience here with us today. Gerda Lerner committed her papers to the Schlesinger Library some decades ago, but it has been only because of Stephanie Lapidus's cooperation and great help that the library has been able to acquire the personal papers personal materials that were still in the family's possession at the time of Gerda's death earlier this year. I'm very grateful to Stephanie Lapidus, and I want to invite her just now to say a few words that I know she wants to address to you, the audience.
First, I want to test, can you hear me, everyone's? Okay, good. First, thank you to the Schlesinger for preserving my mother's writing and to the presenters and participants here today. It really means a lot to me to be here. I want to share briefly with you my experience organizing and reading through my mother's documents before I began to pack and ship them off to the Schlesinger. This was quite an experience, and I think a unique one to go through your mother's personal writing, and it enabled me to touch her spirit and learn many new things about her complete life. My mother chronicled everything, and I mean everything, in great detail. A whole person is conveyed as she describes 9 decades of living in vivid detail. Her letters reveal relationship turbulence and vulnerability, as well as confidence, strong principles, and her passionate determination to make the world a better place. You will hear her remembered today, probably, as writer, teacher, historian. We've heard about her role as feminist and political activist. Captured in her writing are other time frames and capacities in which she engaged with life. Gerda as a teenager, parent, young widow, as grandmother, traveler, cultural connoisseur, lover, backpacker, and loyal friend. I held my mom's Viennese baccalaureate thesis on the German ballad in my hands for the first time, read diaries about her cultured Viennese childhood, and notes which track the emerging contours of her bold, energetic, creative mind. Pouring through photographic journals and poems, her worldwide travels come to life. She took annual hiking trips in wild landscapes where she climbed high mountain paths and carried her food supply on her back. Sleeping on the earth and simplicity gave Mom perspective, balance, and inspiration. Gerda's engaged and reflective way of experiencing is resurrected in this archive. It is possible now for anyone to meet my mother intimately and as a multidimensional person. Thank you for letting me say a few words.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, in thinking about this 70th anniversary event, I immediately thought back to the parallel events that I had attended for the library's 40th, 50th, and 60th. And it's quite striking that Gerda Lerner was on the program for all the previous anniversaries, and so was Anne Fuhrer Scott, the Southern historian who is another founding mother of the contemporary women's history field. The title of the 40th anniversary program was Celebrating Women's Lives, and it included, I remember this extremely well, an unplanned but no less memorable incident in which Gerda Lerner, from the audience in response to someone else's paper, formulated Lerner's Law. And maybe later I'll have time to tell you what that was. The 50th anniversary was a bigger show. It was called New Viewpoints in Women's History, and it was masterminded by Susan Ware, who is in the audience, I believe. It brought together a great deal of the exciting scholarship that had been bursting out in the 1980s and early 1990s, and it is the only one of the anniversaries that resulted in a printed publication, due no doubt to Susan Ware's effectiveness. That conference was opened by Anne Fuhrer Scott, while Gerda Lerner offered the closing remarks, in which she declared confidently, as was her wont, I quote, "Patriarchal ideas are obsolete and powerless. Feminist ideas, conversely, are future-oriented and powerful," end quote. The 60th anniversary event took place after I became director of the library. We called it Gender, Race, and Rights, and focused the program on African-American women's history. a focus that, again, very suitably brought the participations of historians Anne Ferris Scott and Gerda Lerner. Lerner's 1972 anthology, Black Women in White America, had powerfully urged women's historians from the very beginning of the contemporary field to merge thinking about race with their thinking about women and gender. The title of our event today, Why History Matters, mimics the title of one of Lerner's collections of essays. She deeply believed that history does matter and that making women subjects and agents of history in history matters. And all our panelists today embrace that premise too. I've given our speakers a double task, asking them to reflect both on the history of women's history over the past 40 or 50 years, and to comment on Gerda Lerner's contribution to it. Each of our speakers is eminent in the history of women and gender. Each takes a distinctive scholarly angle, and each of them knew Gerda Lerner well, although from a particular time and context that is not the same as any of the others. So I think we have a treat ahead of us, an assemblage of ideas and reflections and theories that will combine historiography with personal memory. And our plan is that the speakers will offer brief remarks, one after the other, moving in alphabetical order of their names, their last names. Then we will convene up here as a panel for some give and take among us. And third, we will ask you, the audience, to offer your comments and questions. And as Liz mentioned, the event will conclude with a reception in the next building to which you are all invited. Now, I'm going to do an unorthodox thing, which is I am not going to introduce our speakers individually. You have on your seat a card which offers the very briefest but informative biographies on the back. I would love to go on at length telling you about the accomplishments of each of our speakers, about my admiration for their work, and about their path-breaking contributions, which are many. But in the interest of time, I will forbear and refer you to the printed texts. I want to simply say I am tremendously grateful to all of them for being enthusiastic about participating in this event. And the order in which you will hear them is as follows: Joyce Antler, Thavolia Glymph, Linda Gordon, Linda Kerber, and Alice Kessler-Harris. And after Alice concludes, we will then assemble as a group up here. Thanks so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay. Well, thank you, Nancy and Liz, for giving me the privilege of speaking at this symposium in honor of the 70th anniversary of the Schlesinger Library and Gerda Lerner. What a magnificent pairing. The Schlesinger and Gerda did so much to create, grow, and support women's history. We couldn't be more grateful to both. I do recall all the other Schlesinger anniversary conferences and Gerda, but particularly I remember a moment when the library was celebrating its 40th anniversary. Gerda was chairing the afternoon's presentation, and I was a speaker and extremely pregnant. I remember being barely able to catch my breath. There was very little room in there. Still, Gerda kept on tugging at my shirt, pushing me to speak faster and faster so I wouldn't go over my time. So I can hear her voice now whispering in my ear, and I will try to be sure to stay on time. I've been asked to discuss American Jewish women's history, an area that developed relatively late within women's history. I'd like to begin with a few snapshots that relate to its moments of origin, and then I'll describe some key frameworks and current directions. Snapshot one involves the first Southern Conference on Women's History, held in Spartanburg, South Carolina in June 1988. At a panel on Jewish women in the South, Anne Ferris Scott offered comments on presentations by two graduate students who had written about Southern Jewish women and the Reformed tradition. Although she appreciated their work, Anne doubted that there was a distinctive Southern Jewish women's history, since Jewish women's reform efforts in the South mirrored patterns set by Protestant women. A heated discussion about whether Jewish women should be considered part of mainstream activism ensued. Several speakers argued that Southern Jewish women did need to be treated as a distinct group because of the unique experience of Southern anti-Semitism and the complexity of being outsiders and insiders in Southern society. At the time, I was director of the Women's Studies program at Brandeis, and I spontaneously proposed a conference on the subject of U.S. Jewish women's history to consider the questions being raised. Clara Schiffer, a dear friend of the Schlesinger Library, was in the audience and offered to fund the conference. It took a few years, but in 1993, Brandeis held the first conference on U.S. Jewish women's history. The second snapshot concerns Gerda, who was the first person I called as I began to plan the conference. I asked Gerda if she would be interested in speaking about the connections between her identity as a Jew and her work as a historian, specifically as historian of women. Gerda was not happy with the question, and quite unceremoniously, she hung up. A few minutes later, maybe it was no more than 10, she called back to say that while she had never given this issue even a moment's thought, it was among the most profound questions she had ever been asked. I am a historian because of my Jewish experience, she proclaimed at our conference. She did come in the midst of a terrible snowstorm. It was the blizzard of the century. And in fact, she wound up staying snowbound at my house for a few days. That's another story. Ask my daughters. They have a real lot to say about that time. To be a Jew meant to live in history, Gerda said. After the Holocaust, history for me was no longer something outside which I needed to comprehend and use to illuminate my own life and times. History had become an obligation. Growing up as a Jewish female, Gerda experienced double difference, marginality and exclusion as a Jew, but also as a Jewish woman. In protest, she refused to go through with her own bat mitzvah. My first feminist actions came out of experiences as a Jewish woman, she recalled. Quote, to comprehend analytically what I experienced and learned as a prototypical outsider, a woman, a Jew, an exile, she became a historian, choosing race as her subspecialty within women's history, since it was the major issue in U.S. history, and since African Americans, not Jews, were, in her words, the targeted outgroup. It was only at the very end of her career that Gerda began to consider Jewish women's history. For much of her life, she had identified Jews with particularity, nationality, religion, Zionism. Wanting to transcend these limits, she saw her choices as either or. Thus, she kept religion and nationality, the element she saw as characteristic of Jewish history, apart from her inquiries into gender, class, and race. Only late did she become aware of Jewish women's, quote, complex weave of connections, of multiple causes of interdependencies, leading her to see beyond the binary. A weave of connections, her essay, which grew out of our conference and which is the first essay in the book, Why History Matters, describes her growing understanding. Perhaps we could talk more about Gerda's attitudes about this Jewish woman's history in the Q&A. I would only add now that Gerda was a great champion of the Jewish Women's Archive, an independent organization created in 1995 to promote the collection and transmission of North American Jewish women's history, and she happily served on the Academic Advisory Council, which I chair. She particularly loved the fact that JWA existed outside the academy and targeted a general as well as academic audience, which was part of her vision for women's history. Another milestone in the creation of American Jewish women's history, which pleased Gerda, was the 1997 publication of the two-volume historical encyclopedia, Jewish Women in America, edited by Paula Hyman and Deborah Dash Moore. Coming 4 years after the Black Women's Encyclopedia, edited by Darlene Clark Hine, and influenced by that important work, the Jewish Women's volumes included 800 individual biographies and 110 topical essays. Hyman and Moore's goal was to recover the history of American Jewish women, which they felt had been absent in Jewish reference works, and they also believed this omission characterized American women's history, a history in which Jewish women remained invisible as Jews, they said, because their Jewishness is not considered relevant to their achievements. Thus, they concluded, quote, Jewish women are not constructed as a category of knowledge. This statement flagged a problem in the development of American Jewish women's history as a field. While it had been more than 20 years since the publication of Hyman's landmark 1976 book, The Jewish Women in America, co-authored with Charlotte Baum and Sonia Michel, relatively few studies appeared in the general historical literature about American Jewish women. This neglect paralleled the slow emergence of women and gender in modern Jewish history. By the 1990s, Jewish women had begun to appear in American historical narratives like Susan Glenn's Daughter of the Shtetl and Annalise Orlick's Common Sense and a Little Fire, none of which had Jewish in the subtitle, by the way. But the complexity of Jewish women's identity in modern America stymied a more fulsome examination of Jewish women's role in the American experience. If many American Jews had fallen away from religious practices or identification with group norms, did Jews, about 2% of the population, constitute a coherent political or identity group? If they had become white by the mid-20th century, as several scholars proclaimed, did they fit the category of minority? Were they still ethnic? What about minimalist or non-Jewish Jews who identified with Americanism or the less particularist, more universalist identity, much in the fashion of Lillian Hellman, whose complex Jewish identity Alice Kessler-Harris so brilliantly explicates in her biography? Finally, should Jews be included in the catalog of a multicultural America? Vicki Ruiz and Ellen Du Bois's most recent edition of Unequal Sisters offers one article specifically identified as about Jewish women, it's my own, about the Emma Lazarus Federation, but another in which Jewish women are among key subjects, Annalise Orlick's study of militant housewives during the Great Depression, but not identified as such. The volume also includes Daniel Horowitz's piece on Betty Friedan, Labor Radicalism and Feminism, where Friedan's Jewishness, including her self-identification as Jewish outsider, is not mentioned. Here is one example of the problem that Hyman and Moore iterated. Even when the women themselves are present, their Jewishness, whether religious or secular, immigrant or ethnic, white, middle class, or other, is rarely identified or interrogated. A 2009 discussion in the journal American Jewish History, initiated by an article by historian David Hollinger in response to one by Hassia Diner and Tony Michaels, frames this question. Hollinger criticized historians of American Jewish history for a narrow focus on self-identified Jews and their institutions, which he called communalist history, rather than a broad dispersionist history, that is, all persons with a Jewish ancestry, regardless of their degree of involvement with communal Jewry. Unless the experience of secular or even non-Jewish Jews was studied along with the religious and institutionally engaged ones, Hollinger believed that Jews would remain marginal to the narrative of American history. Similar to his call for post-ethnic studies, he now called for post-Jewishness. Interestingly, Hollinger's claims about the significance of dispersionist history were based on the unacknowledged role of non-identified Jewish feminists in the creation of women's liberation. The research, as it happens, that I've been conducting over the past few years for a book on radical feminism and Jewish identity, I think validates but complicates this idea. For example, most Jewish women who composed the predominantly Jewish core of women's liberation groups in big Eastern cities didn't identify as Jews, and they gravitated to a more universalist vision of social change, but others were profoundly influenced by Jewish values, experiences, institutions, or their outsider status. We might say that rather than opposing paradigms, dispersionist history intersects and often conflicts with communalist history, especially when gender is involved. Melissa Clapper's important new book, Ballots, Babies, and Banners of Peace, American Jewish Women's Activism, 1890 to 1940, finds an even greater complementarity between Jewish identity and wider feminist activism. Other recent works, like Karen McGinnity's Still Jewish, a study of Jewish women and intermarriage in the 20th century, similarly centers on relationships of Jewish women with non-Jewish and Jewish cohorts, acknowledging multiple aspects of heritage and experience. Looking at that clock there. Many aspects of Jewish women's history fit a possibly post-Jewish paradigm of flux, hybridity, and contingency, and allows us to see, as Susanna Heschel did, writing about women and Judaism, that it was the radical distinctions between the history of the experience of men and women within Judaism that characterized the multiplicity of Jewish life, and I think that holds for the story of American Jewish women in American history as well. Their study provides another pluralist, intersectional lens for analysis. Gerda's essay, Why History Matters, usefully compares the experiences of Jews and women. The way experience interacts with thought in the formation of personal identity, she says, illustrates that Jews created a unique historical consciousness. Because Jews always knew their history, they were able to survive persecution, not internalizing their oppression. Women, however, when denied knowledge of their histories, became unaware of alternatives to their marginalization. Gerda also located key similarities between Jews and women. For both groups, historically based differences led to behaviors which were distinguishable from those of members of the dominant group. Those are her words. In recent decades, scholars writing about American Jewish women from the perspective of gender have offered nuanced frameworks to illuminate the differences which Gerda saw as enabling both Jewish and female historical consciousness. The most interesting of these studies attempts to locate universalism through particularities, and I'd like to give you very briefly some examples of current trends in American Jewish women's history. One, historians of American Jewish women have paid most attention to the influence of gender on religious identity, practices, organizations, whether in the home, family, synagogue, or the wider community, offering imaginative demonstrations of Anne Brown's statement that women's history is religious history, anthologies like Marion Kaplan and Deborah Dash Moore's Gender and Jewish History, Pamela Dell and Jonathan Sana's Women and American Judaism, Revell and Prell's Women Remaking American Judaism, and there are more, explore the intersection of Judaism and feminism. These volumes indicate how powerfully the lens of gender has reshaped the writing of modern Jewish history, and I venture to guess the history of other American faith traditions as well. A second direction in American Jewish women's history problematizes ethnicity as a historical category. Examining the varying social locations of ethnicity, scholars have interrogated the changing meanings of Jews' hyphenated identities, complicating questions of whiteness, Americanness, mainstream, and marginality. In Matthew Jacobson's view, which I agree with, outsider status conferred by ethnicity has been critical to the development of American feminism. Explorations of ethnicity have also revamped migration studies, as historians like Audrey Nasser have negotiated new terrain with studies of Egyptian and other Mizrahi, as well as Sephardic immigrants to America, challenging dominant paradigms of immigration. Three, as in general Jewish studies, much work on American Jewish history has been interdisciplinary, with important contributions coming not only from American historians, but from anthropologists, sociologists, literary scholars, and religious studies scholars. Four, with deep connections to diaspora communities in Europe, the Middle East, Asia, and the Americas, American Jewish women's history readily lends itself to a focus on transnational, comparative, and global history. Rebecca Coburn's study on the relationship between Bialystok homeland, diaspora communities, Bonnie Anderson and Ellen Du Bois' work on Jewish women's leadership and international feminism. These are only a few examples of this trend. A fifth pattern concerns studies of Jewish masculinity. In the past, Jewish manhood studies focused on European rather than American context, perhaps because of the overriding importance of anti-Semitism in that experience. Yet as Beth Wenger's work on masculinity shows, constructions of manhood and sexuality have been critical to the formation of American Jewish women's identities and to influential popular cultural portrayals of Jewish gender. The characterization of Jewish men and women, sexuality and the body in popular culture and literature continues to be a potent source for understanding the persistence of Jewish ethnicity. The last trend picks up on what Karen Brotkin named Jews' racial middleness, a concept used by Deborah Schultz in her study Going South, Jewish Women in the Civil Rights Movement. Schultz demonstrates that Jewish women's dual vision allowed them to negotiate multiple changes in class, gender, racial, and ethnic norms, embracing their inheritance as critically thinking outsiders and breaking the rules. Studies about the meanings of whiteness and racial construction from the perspective of Jewish women, for example, Laurie Harrison Kahn's The White Negress and work by Eric Goldstein, indicate further possibilities for these kinds of intersections. All of these studies point the way to a vibrant examination of how Jewish identities have been constructed and how they have been linked with gender, how the question of Jewishness is related to the question of other non-Black groups, as well as to African-American history, and how, finally, Jewish women may be constructed as a category of knowledge, as Hyman and Moore wanted, or at least as relationships that deal with these issues. We are only at the beginning, I believe, but I agree with Hollinger and others that explicating the multiple pathways of Jewish women's lives will have profound meaning for the writing of American history. In Gerda's insightful phrase quoted earlier, Jewish women's history has been comprised of, quote, a complex weave of connections, of multiple causes, of interdependencies. She left it to us to explain why, how, where, and when. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's really a pleasure to be here and to be among such distinguished panelists. I owe so much to all of you, so thank you, and so many of you in the audience as well. So thank you, Nancy and Dean Cohen, for inviting me to this program. And I'm also very, very worried about Gerda's diary and journal. The last time I saw Gerda was in Wisconsin in her apartment a few months before she passed. And we talked about many things, but not much about history. So if you want to know my life, go to the Schlesinger. Okay. Over the past few months, I thought a lot about this event and what I would say. What could I say? I read and reread materials I thought relevant about Gerda, about her body of work, women's history broadly, and more particularly, Black women's history. I thought deeply about Black and white women in the Academy and the ties that bind the project of writing women's history and the project of producing historians who are not men, as well as the forces that are divisive. I thought and read some more. I wrote nothing. The more I thought about the unwritten paper, the more paralyzed I became. This paralysis I eventually came to see was not your typical writer's block kind of thing, but rather ensued from a self-located state, a self-located state of willful forgetting, though I am sure I had some help along the way. So in the end, it seemed fitting that I take the opportunity of this occasion, celebrating the 70th anniversary of this important library and the work of Gerda Lerner, to reflect briefly on what the state of willful amnesia means, in particular for how I see Gerda's work, the projects in particular that she was so passionately committed to that relate to Black women's history. Preparing for this talk, the reading and the thinking made clear not only my willful forgetfulness, but the dangers of such a state of mind. This program that has alerted me in a way I had not thought about for a long time, of the power of what has been accomplished in women's history and its fragility. It is easy to forget how short is the temporal space that separates where women's history is today and where it was before the 1960s. The great outpouring of work in women's history over the past four decades has been incredibly exciting, and it has fundamentally changed how we do history and thus how the world is explained. Sometimes it can seem as if this always was. Going back, however, to the pioneering work that forged the path to where we are today, from even before Gerda to women like Gertrude Mazel, who published the work of the Afro-American woman in 1908, and past Gerda to many historians who are here today and others who are now not, like Rosalind Terborg Pinn and Darlene Clark Hine and Elsa Barkley Brown, to name a few, to projects like the Black Women Oral History Project supported by this library that interviewed 72 Black women between 1976 and 1981. Going back and forward, one is forcefully reminded of the battles that had to be fought and the debts owed to those who were in the thick of those battles, including the other panelists here today. Battles too easily forgotten as a new and ever more exciting book on women's history seems to land on our desk every day. Gerda wrote passionately about the problem of forgetting. In particular, I was thinking about, in as I thought about what I would say today, I was thinking about what she had said about losing her ability to speak German, and I went back to find these notes. And she wrote, quote, "My writing, my intense drive to become an American writer has pushed me into leaving the language of my childhood behind, never counting the cost. Through my writing, I had found the way back, but now the cost seems enormous. The return of the mother tongue has brought some healing of the other losses, but memory is different now. Before, what was lost sank into a deep hole of oblivion. One covered it up and built anew, forgetting the cost. Now memory includes what was lost and what it cost, and what might have been had I been able to write in my own language. I might have tapped," she said, "my way along the guiding rope of language and found a richer, more poetic voice for what I had to say. For in translation, one becomes a trickster, too clever by far and too concerned with mastery." It was one of her many moments of introspection, and it set the tone and theme for what I thought I should say to this afternoon. Women's history is where it is today, not only because the scholarly community came to recognize, if not always happily or with appreciation, that there was, as Gerda said, a female aspect to history. And it had been, as she also and others reminded us, covered up. But she was concerned about this covering up that we can do too as we build anew, forgetting the cost. And that is what I think explains, in part, my forgetfulness. In part, the battle was won because women historians became masters of the language that had been used to exclude them, and because they learned a new language and began to find their own voices, yet still quite tricky. Mastery of the master's voice, as Gerda wrote in speaking about her years as a graduate student, was absolutely essential, but one had to be careful, Gerda worried, not to become a trickster, too clever by far and too concerned with mastery. Lucky for us all, pioneering scholars of women's history provided lessons in how to avoid the trap of becoming tricksters, no matter how bad we have sometimes been as students. Their critique of established history was also a critique of voice, of the language in which power was ensconced. They became masters of the history, of the history of language. They devised new analytical strategies and attached new meanings to the most powerful of words in the arsenal of men's history, words like patriarchy. That innocent-sounding word and the innocent-sounding definition as a social organization marked by the supremacy of the father in the clan or the family looked very different when Gerda and others defined it as a system of dominance based on the invention that arbitrary differences among people can be used to construct categories in which the unequal distribution of resources and power by small elites over large and diverse populations is justified. It is not difference, Gerda wrote, that's the problem. It is dominance justified by appeals to constructed difference that is the problem. And this was especially true for Black women's history. As many of the women again here today, Linda and Alice, who wrote that wonderful collection, Women in History, edited this wonderful collection, Women in History, that others in the audience wrote essays for. This collection of pioneering essays, Women in History, New Feminist Essays, by leading scholars of women's history, was dedicated to Gerda. And the editors wrote, quote, "Her scholarly work began with a stubborn insistence that sources could be found to study even the poorest and the most subordinated of women. That insistence has stretched the boundaries of our knowledge about women's lives and encouraged us to ask questions that we didn't consider possible. Gerda's Black Women in White America, published in 1972, is a testament to this insistence. This book is important for publishing over 160 documents tracing the history of Black women in America from 1811 to 1971, the first such systematic effort of its kind. But Gerda did more than say to us, here are some documents. In tracking these documents down in archives and libraries across the country and going to the homes of Black people, she proved that the problem was not that the sources could not be found or were non-existent. And that, for me, as a young person just beginning to discover women's history and Black women's history, was a thrilling revelation. It was not that I had not already read about Black women in history, but the documents in Black women in White America, and I still have the copy I purchased in 1973 when the paperback version became available. That book introduced me to women like Margaret Garner. I had never heard of her before. Gerda's book introduced me for the first time to Amy Spain, the Black woman who was executed, hanged in Richmond for expressing happiness about being free in 1865, not in Richmond, South Carolina, I'm sorry. That book introduced me to the Memphis Riot. It introduced me to questions about how peonage in the South as a new form of slavery carried over the sexual abuse of Black women in strikingly familiar ways. Black women in White America introduced me for the first time to Black women tobacco workers in Durham, and it introduced me for the first time to Patsy, now of the movie 12 Years a Slave, or famous now because of that movie. But if you go back and you read Black Women in America, just a section on Patsy, the short excerpt taken from the narrative of Solomon Northrup, who I also had not known about before. On Patsy, introduced me to the narrative too. And for all of you who have seen the movie and not read the book, this short passage that Gerda provided is a stark reminder of how history gets lost. In terms of the labor she performed, the movie focuses on her ability to pick cotton. 2 minutes. But Northrup wrote that she was also a skilled teamster, that Patsy could turn a furrow as true as the best, that Patsy also was very good at splitting rails. When I first picked up this book, I also marveled at Gerda's effort to document this history, one that took her not only to the state archives, but as I said, to Black churches and families. And I found her bibliographical notes and still find them a treasure. I valued that book, and I valued it also because it was not organized chronologically, but topically. The section on domestic work included documents from 1912, 1940, 1937, and 1970. The documents in Survival as a Form of Resistance covered a 100-year period from 1865 to 1964. The personal was political, and in Gerda's case, the personal had taught her that Black women's near invisibility in the profession and the scholarship was a function of scholarly neglect and racist assumptions. In Vienna, she had worked with women in the underground movement, and in jail, she had experienced women's presence in history. And then in America, she said, "When I worked with Black women, I was overwhelmed by the talent and persistence of their effort and their total invisibility." And that led me, she wrote, to write Black women in America. When told they left no record, her response was, "I knew that had to be a lie. My life experience told me that." As Linda Gordon has observed, this book was a political act. Still, it would take much longer for political acts such as Gerda's to bear fruit. As Darlene Clark Hine would write a quarter of a century later, in the late 1960s, Black women fell through the cracks between emerging Black studies and women's studies on most of the nation's campuses. By the 1980s, both Black history and women's history had become accepted and legitimate areas of scholarly inquiry. Few scholars, Hine wrote, noticed the absence of Black women, let alone their contributions in the realm of material culture. In the end, of course, in this void, Darlene Hine would wade deep with a body of work that went far towards resetting the course for Black women's history. And she would witness firsthand how hard it was for even an established scholar like herself to get work published on Black women. Black Women in America, a historical encyclopedia published in 1994, was a triumph against many odds. Even the seemingly straightforward matter of inviting people to the advisory board, Hein wrote, was a significant, again, political gesture, because at the time, Black women scholars were not routinely invited to serve on editorial boards of mainstream publishing or media projects. And at the time, there was not one Black woman who had ever co-authored a general undergraduate textbook in American history. The publication of this encyclopedia was the result also of an unprecedented collaboration of students and scholars from all over the country and indeed the world, some of whom reached into their own pockets to help make this work. It was also into this climate that other scholars, Black and white, stepped to change things, and I could mention a few, but I've run out of time. But I do want to at least call out Deborah Gray White's name. And I want to just end, if I could have 1 minute, I want to end with a poem by Adrienne Rich, because it so exemplifies my effort to now remember more and to honor Gerda and the work of scholars like her. This is just a small bit from Adrienne Rich's poem called Grandmothers, about her grandmother, Mary Gravely Jones. You were Mary, widow of William and no matriarch, yet smoldering to the end with frustrate life, ideas nobody listened to, least of all my father. One summer night, you sat with my sister and me in the wooden glider long after twilight, holding us there with streams of pent-up words. You could quote every poet I had ever heard of, had read The Opium Eater, Emile, and Bernard Shaw. Your green eyes looked clenched against opposition. You married straight out of the convent school. Your background was country. You left an unperformed typescript of a play about Burr and Hamilton. You were impotent and brilliant. No one cared about your mind. You might have ended elsewhere in that glider, elsewhere than in that glider, reciting your unwritten novels to the children. Every time I read that poem, all I can say is imagine. Rich's grandmother was likely born in the mid to late 19th century, and she was reading The Opium Eater, but no one cared. Thank you.
I want to thank everyone, and not only the people who did all the work, and not only the people that came, but I also want to use this moment, if I can, to just offer particular thanks to these people at the Radcliffe Institute who have given me a really wonderful gift, which is a year free from teaching to do my work. It's so much appreciated. When we divvied up what each of us would talk about, and we decided that my part would be Gerda Lerner and social movements, I thought to myself, well, Gerda was a social movement. And those of us who know her will chuckle about this, thinking of her forcefulness, but I also mean it quite seriously. Like a social movement, she actually had the power to change people. Unlike many scholars, Gerda was a sensationally good motivational speaker. Easily the equal of the professional inspirational speakers who get $50,000 a talk for ratcheting up businessmen's competitiveness. I have actually met many people who said that listening to a Gerda Lerner lecture converted them either to feminism or to women's history. And I also want to point out that this ability to motivate others is also found in her ability to write extremely well, and in her second language. If you want an example, just take a look at her memoir, A Death of One's Own. Her husband, Carl Lerner, had developed a malignant brain tumor while still a very young man, and after nursing him through months of suffering and feeling this love of her life slipping away from her, she wrote a powerful and painfully honest account of their relationship, of the issues involved in tending to him, of his right to know the full facts of his illness, and her insistence that the doctors respect that right, and of the violence and mystery of death. She interestingly used that frank confrontation with death again in her last years while living in the Oakwood home in Madison. She produced a wonderful, with a photographer friend, a wonderful photo textual book about aging, which I commend to you. And she also led a workshop for other residents in the home about aging and dying. But the fact is that she did not much focus her prodigious energy on her own life. She had much greater ambitions. As people have said, she meant to change the world. She had a long list of concerns: racism, war, poverty, imperialism, religious intolerance, environmental destruction, authoritarian regimes, and the older she got, the longer the list became. But starting sometime in the 1940s, patriarchy became her chief enemy. And her weapon of choice was women's history. In other words, to her, literally, women's history was itself a social movement. And she was a missionary, an organizer, and a preacher about the importance of history. Now, there are many sayings about the importance of history, and a lot of people in this room know them, that history telling is extremely vital to the power structure of any society. One saying, history is always written by the victors. Another, that history is the art of kings. There's an African saying that goes, until the lion can speak, history will always glorify the hunter. I might also commend to you Josephine Tay's wonderful murder mystery, The Daughter of Time, which shows how the Tudor dynasty actually manufactured the mythology about the crooked and evil Richard III. But Gerda had no illusion that she could change the world simply by writing history, or not even just by teaching and lecturing. She was an organizer with a very keen sense of strategy. In both of her faculty positions at Sarah Lawrence and at the University of Wisconsin, she recognized that merely teaching courses in women's history would not be enough to build respect for the field. And I do want to remind the younger people here that we're talking about a field that had very little respect, to say the least, from a lot of mainstream historians at a certain point. So Gerda maneuvered to build history, women's history programs that would have visibility and autonomy. At Wisconsin, she had the chutzpah to set a condition on accepting the job offer. And I say chutzpah because the Wisconsin faculty thought that they were doing her a very great favor by offering her a job. Her condition was that they had to hire a second faculty member in women's history. And that position, luckily for me, went to me. And so for 16 years, I was Gerda's closest colleague, and for all the years afterward, her summertime friend and sometimes caretaker. The visibility of these programs, for which Gerda was such an indefatigable saleswoman, attracted top-notch students to lots of places that began teaching women's history. Gerda also organized the first, and possibly still the only, I'm not sure, national conference of women's historians who were training graduate students. Thinking, as always, like an organizer, she wanted to get us together so that we could exchange ideas about best practices and to share our experiences and our syllabi. At Wisconsin, this was not enough. We required all of our women's history graduate students to do outreach work, and they decided that they were going to proselytize into public schools, and over the years they made slideshows about various aspects of women's history. One was about work, one was about sports, one was about education, one was about feminism. Not only that, but each slideshow had two versions, one for elementary school kids and one for high school kids, and then they went around and performed these at a lot of schools in Wisconsin. The Schlesinger Library, now the home of Gerda's papers, fits perfectly into her history as a social movement perspective. I think it's extremely important to note, as Nancy pointed out at the beginning, that this library was established in a period that historians for a long time described as the doldrums between what has been called the first wave and the second wave of feminism, a period during which a lot of people thought that nothing really was happening, not to mention the fact that it was established in the middle of World War II. And I think its very existence suggests some of the things that were wrong with thinking of that period as the doldrums. When women's history then reached what economists call a takeoff point, maybe 1969, maybe 1970, the Schlesinger was clearly the base for that. It was the Schlesinger Library and the collecting work that had been done when so many thought nothing was being done that showed my generation that it was possible to write women's history. And there's a perfect parallel with Gerda's work here because it, as Thavolia just told us, because in some ways her creation of Black women in white America was creating an archive. African American history was a rapidly growing field by then, but neither books nor articles focused on Black women were available. And as Thavolia pointed out, there were doubters who said this is a history that cannot be written because the sources aren't there. And by creating this kind of beginning archive, the book functioned like all good archives, which is it not only provided a base, but it then provides clues from which people go out and search for other sources. Gerda may have been born with extraordinary drive, but she wasn't born with these skills as an organizer. She learned those. She learned them first in Vienna, from school friends who carried on underground resistance to the Nazis, from women who were in a Nazi prison with her. She learned more from the American Popular Front, from the American Communist Party. She practiced these skills in the Congress of American Women and in the National Organization of Women. She was embedded in social movements for a very large part of her life, but when it came to historical work about social movements, she brought, I think, two really very important intellectual understandings that I think have been tremendously influential throughout the field. One is that all historical analysis requires understanding how power works and how the subjects of that power respond to it. And the other understanding is that various forms of power are all related. She learned her feminism in large part from observing both German and American racism, and then the McCarthyist red-baiting that drove her husband out of his work as a Hollywood film editor and director. She was a master interpreter of the interrelatedness of various forms of domination. This is something that academic feminists today call intersectionality. I think myself that that's really just a multisyllabic new label for a very old understanding, and that understanding was just Gerda's default. Her 1969 article, The Lady and the Mill Girl, was tremendously influential because it was fundamentally about class differences among women. And in 1963, long before that, she wrote a letter to Betty Friedan as soon as she had read Betty Friedan's book. And she thanked Betty Friedan because she loved her passionate, angry feminist approach, but she criticized her for thinking only about privileged women. Both sides of that seem to me very emblematic of Gerda. She really liked anger and defiance, but she was not going to sacrifice complexity because of that. She never believed that politeness, moderation, and compromise were the best ways to get what she wanted. And if you ask me, I can tell you some of the things that she complained about President Obama. Those of us who experienced the force of her personality and her success in overcoming opposition, we should not forget that she too suffered the slights and the insults that were hurled at ambitious women. And we should not imagine that they didn't hurt. I was recently writing about another very complicated and driven woman who was 25 years older than Gerda. And one of the things I learned from that woman, and it was still true in Gerda's time, is that ambition was probably the least acceptable attribute in a woman. A lot of other things could be forgiven, but too much ambition put you absolutely outside of being a lady. It interested me to register just recently for the first time that the former Radcliffe president, Martina Horner, whose name is attached to my fellowship here, she is the person who actually provided the science that showed how women were taught to fear and to suppress ambition. So I think that not the least of Gerda's messages to a later generation, and I see these as messages not only to historians but also to movement activists, is not to fear their own ambition. At one of her very last meetings with our large cohort of graduate students at Wisconsin, Gerda made a threat, and I think I'll end with that. She said to them, this was maybe a couple years before her death, but she knew that she was failing. She said to them, "Don't think that when I die, I won't be watching you. If you don't continue to write about women, I will come back to haunt you, and you will never be able to sleep."
It's a real pleasure to be here, and I thank Nancy and Liz Cohn for inviting me. I thank the Schlesingers, dead and alive, for making this enterprise be. I thank the community of Radcliffe, from the past into the present, dead and alive, for making a space for women of intellect and for women's study that has been so powerful, so present, and so flexible over the years, and has changed itself over the years, over the centuries actually now, and remains a source of great support to our life, intellectual and social. Nancy asked us to reflect on five decades of change in women's history, and my assignment, as you may have guessed, is to reflect on the subjects, the topics of citizenship, law, and politics, which have been one way or another. I hadn't realized it when I was picking subjects. I thought I was just doing one thing after another, but when you look at what I've written, yep, falls into place. And so as I look at that and think what falls into place and think 50 years ago, 50 years ago gets us to 1963. It was the year that Gerda entered graduate school at Columbia, and it was a year when I was studying for my oral examinations in the PhD program in history at Columbia. And it is a measure of how off-putting, demoralizing, hostile an environment Columbia University was at that time to graduate students. I think Alice must have changed things. That I had no clue that she was there. She had no clue that I was there. So, and over the years, what I have thought of when I think of that time is I think of academic malpractice at Columbia 50 years ago, and so I'm going to start with this accusation because you've given me a chance to say it. So 50 years ago, I'm preparing for orals at Columbia University. It's 1963, and I am clinging for dear life to two doorstop books. One is Henry Steele Commager's Documents of American History. The other is Richard Morris's Encyclopedia of American History. And they are giving me a time frame. They are giving me a structure to pin against the wall all those confusing interpretations which all those other books are offering and are making me dizzy. But these books are giving me the key statutes, the key court decisions, the culmination of political argument that I can trust. Marbury versus Madison, Dred Scott, Mueller versus Aragon, they map the landscape for me, and I cling to them, and I survive, and I go on to write a dissertation. Only years and years later, amidst the political movement of second wave feminism, do I scratch my head and I'm hunting up things in these books. I cannot find the Expatriation Act of 1907. This is a statute that provided that when an American woman married a foreign man, she lost her citizenship. And the debates in Congress on this statute are remarkably witty, funny, and crazy. They are sparked by the marriage of Consuelo Vanderbilt to the Duke of Marlborough. And everyone in Congress is saying, couldn't the richest young woman in America find a decent American man to marry? And so they write into statute a long-established practice. Neither book included the U.S. Supreme Court's decision in McKenzie versus Hare in 1915, when the Supreme Court upheld that statute, ruling that when an American woman married a foreign man, she had engaged in voluntary expatriation. And the result would be that thousands of women citizens who had married German men had to register as enemy aliens during World War I. And if her husband's nation did not automatically make her a citizen at the moment of marriage, she was exposed to statelessness. Morris, but not Commager, included a brief note to the effect that the Cable Act of 1922, which is something the suffragists used their vote to press for, granted married women U.S. citizenship independent of their husband's status. He did not explain why such a statute had been needed, nor did he explain that the grant of citizenship, the confirmation of citizenship, did not apply to women who married men who were not themselves eligible for naturalization, which in 1922 included Asians, included Japanese, Koreans, people from South India. And the law would not be fully fixed until the mid-20th century. On occasion, when I'm feeling grouchy, I will use a story like this as a test. I can find myself in a room full of lawyers, and I can say, when do you suppose they stopped the practice of removing birthright citizenship from American women if they married foreign men? And it is, I don't think I have yet met a random lawyer who knows it. And so we giggle. I giggle. But it's not funny. Because what was hiding in plain sight, what remains hidden in plain sight, is that even in a political system that regularly spoke in generic terms and thought of itself as dedicated to equality, think the 14th Amendment, all persons born or naturalized in the United States are citizens of the United States, women's citizenship was unstable, women's very nationality vulnerable to instant erasure when she chose to marry, when she met certain conditions, men in the United States never lost their nationality at marriage. Loss of nationality, as you know, shaped Gerda's life, and she never forgot it. But it remains today a live issue. There are still 29 countries where women will lose their nationality at marriage or inherit an unstable nationality. So then my question for this last 50 years of U.S. of women's history is, how do we understand this? And I think of Clifford Geertz's observation that common sense is not what the mind free of presuppositions intuits, it's what the mind full of presuppositions concludes. And I am reminded, or I come to understand, that the common sense of 50 years ago and more was soaked with the presupposition that significant political actors are and must be white men. And one way of thinking about the change over that half century since 1963 may well be simply to say we have undermined that confidence, and that itself is worth having done. We have not eliminated, but we are historians. We know that 50 years is an eye blink in the long history of patriarchy, which Gerda fearlessly, crazily undertook to track since Gilgamesh. Another way, so that's my first point. My second point is that another way that the history of citizenship law and politics has changed over the last 50 years is that we have a richer and wider understanding of contingency, which we have claimed. I need not tell you, and if you, or I simply recommend her autobiography, essentially to The Death of One's Own and Fireweed to you, for details of how Gerda learned the hard way that a woman's relation, that a citizen's relation to their own state is fragile. Imprisoned at 17, she writes, I only knew that as a Jew there were no more rules, as a stateless person, there were no more rules or laws protecting me. Central to this understanding that she comes to when she is 17, or she reflects on when she's 17, is the understanding that women have a different relation to the state and a different relation to history than do men. And that is why one needs a distinctive women's history. So we can find a women's history in everything. That's the other accomplishment, I think, of the last 50 years. No field is safe from us. I'm remembering that Wingspread conference that I think it was Linda who referred to, in which, with two exceptions of people who just couldn't make it at the last minute, there was every single person who taught US women's history in an American university. And what I remember us saying to each other was that we could find race, class, and gender everywhere. And we can. And I hope we've taught more people to do it. In intellectual history, which I see as part of the history of law and citizenship, I point to a book like Michal Sobel's Teach Me Dreams, in which we learn about the dreams that women dream of men, that men dream of women, black people dreaming of white people dreaming of black people. Everything is possible. In political history, all the standard narratives have been shaken up. Women boycotted British goods before and during the revolution. Abolitionist women learned from their abolition to claim women's rights. And I recommend to you a great essay by Gerda that I don't think has been widely reprinted on the way in which the 1848 Declaration of Sentiments is squarely in the context of the intellectual revolutions of 1848 in Europe. And in legal history, which is another way of saying the history of citizenship, another way of thinking of how, it's Thavolia who said, how we reclaim the master's language and use it. We have used that language of citizenship, and we've used it for more than retrieving Ethel Mackenzie, who claimed her citizenship and lost in 1915. When Ruth Bader Ginsburg cracked open 200 years of US practice in the great cases of the early 1970s, her reasoning was soaked with a historical perspective and a critical smashing iconoclasm of assumptions that had been with American law and practice since the founding era. Women are no longer safely caged in family law in law schools. They are everywhere. They're in tax courses. They're in trust and estates. They're in immigration. And one, I end this section by recommending to you an example of one of the great innovations in historical practice in our own time. I recommend to you that you start with the historian's brief in Goodrich versus whatever it is in Massachusetts, the same-sex decision made by Margaret Marshall that was written by Nancy Cott and Mike Grossberg, in which the historian, and many of us signed on, but that work, that conceptualization, offers there a rich, fresh understanding of the of what marriage does in the United States and the relationship of people to it. I want to end. To some extent, all these accomplishments that all of us have been pointing to, in some ways, we're just doing what historians do in all fields. We look for openings, we look for gaps, we look for unread documents, we look for opportunities. But women's history in our own time has been different in part, and I think this was true in the early 20th century too. Women's history has been different because it has been buoyed up by a feminism, by a movement that was hungry for its history, and by a Marxist infusion that insisted there must be theory as well as practice simultaneously, that it was not enough to identify holes and gaps, that you must have an understanding and a philosophy. And that what we were seeking was not only the enrichment of history, but the enrichment of life. Gerda searched for great generalizations. In what I think was my next to last phone conversation with her, we were talking, I'm not even sure what we were talking about, but I guess we were talking about the movie that is being developed about her. And she said, and I was going to be interviewed for it, and she said she was hoping that someone would talk about, I'm quoting now, the impact of my work on the development of women's history. She was impatient for those who couldn't see women's history as a big picture, as an understanding that we lived in history, that the choices we make about the shape of our lives infuse how we understand that past. As early as the essays in The Majority Finds Its Past, she was predicting what the future historiography of women's history would be. She said it was as yet unwritten, but she said there were going to be four stages, and one of them was looking through life like Diogenes with a candle, looking for women, as she had done in the South, in Black women in white America, and it would end with a transformation of what history had been. Late in her life, she was able, as you've heard already, to put together what she understood as Jewish use of historical knowledge and women's use of historical knowledge in a claim that history cannot be separate from life and that it must be energizing. A couple of weeks ago, an op-ed writer in the New York Times spoke of white men who did not understand that they had the wind at their backs. For me, and I know for many of us, Gerda was the wind at my back, fiercely insisting that I not flinch from the big questions, that I try to understand that what we do matters, that there is no separation between the personal and political, that the life choices that we make of lovers and intimates will shape our professional and practical and civic lives, that our goal must include love and craft, bread and roses. I want to end with something that I want to read from something that's in her journal in the archives now. I think it's appropriate to hear her voice as we are just encountering it. It is December 1978, and she has arranged for a conference at Sarah Lawrence College, where she taught. The title of the conference is The Poetics of Political Commitment. And I think it is typical of her that she could put those two together. It is a day that celebrated Muriel Rukeyser, the poet who had had two strokes, is half blind, one cheek sagging, speech and walking impaired, stands erect at the lectern. She speaks without notes, with humor and a plain down-to-earth grittiness. She speaks of writing poems. She says people are always telling you you must choose between having a child and being a poet, between making a living and being a poet, between politics and poetry, false choices, all of these. We must have all of it, says Rukeyser. And that afternoon at a workshop, It seems to Gerda that lots of people are talking and they're defining their own feminism against other people's feminisms, and they've caught themselves in these dualities. And then she scribbles, "I speak from the floor, almost stuttering with emotion. We must have everything, I say, the children, the politics, the children of the brain, of the mind, the intellectual work, the revolutionary commitment. We must encompass the tensions and contradictions and allow each woman her own definition of choices."
I'm not used to K being at the end of the alphabet. So you'll forgive me if I'm in a slightly awkward position, and I'm also looking at the four bottles of water stacked on the, as each person comes up and leaves their bottle of water. I want to start, I did actually write out a talk which I'm gonna read, but I want to start by saying that I knew Gerda best at the point when she was struggling hardest, that is in the 1970s, struggling hardest to establish women's history as a field, as a program or a set of programs, as a legitimate arena of study. And so much of what I want to say, both about Gerda and my experience with her, comes from this sense of a Gerda who was not quite the complete Gerda that she became later. So let me say that at the moment when I got to know her best, I met her in 1969 in a political organizing movement. She was then launching the CCWHP, the Coordinating Committee of Women in the Historical Profession, which was one of the early efforts to change the whole profession. And I met her, I was just out of graduate school at that point, as she was rallying us all. I could testify to Linda's notion that she was a motivational speaker. You couldn't be in a room with her and not leave that room with an agenda that you had not come into the room with. So, but when I met Gerda and got to know her best in the early part of the 1970s, I was struck by the challenges that she felt faced those who wished to do women's history. And they were challenges of revealing the what we then called the contributions of women. We were all, and she was certainly into contribution history. What she wanted to know contributions had women made over the past, what had been overlooked, what had not been seen, what needed to be excavated. Women, she wrote, had not simply been adjuncts to history, they had been an essential component of it. Those early excavations that she and others made opened up the field to hostile questions asked by mostly male colleagues. And the questions always began with, so what? So what if you discover the contributions of women? What difference does it make? What does it teach us about power and change and how things moved from point A to point B? So what if we uncovered women? How did our understanding of the past change when we added women to the mix? What did we now understand that we had previously not understood? Did finding and including women change our conception of the historical process? So what? It's a question that I still ask my graduate students, and it's a question I learned to ask partly because Gerda did not ask it explicitly. She assumed it instead. In the 1980s, we historians of women started to answer that question by rethinking the notion of women's history as a systemic process best comprehended comparatively. That is, by expanding women's history to the history of gender. As students of African American history had already done for race, we historians of women wanted to know how the social relations of the sexes affected historical change. Gerda Lerner initially opposed that innovation. That may come as a surprise to some of you. She feared that historians would be seduced by the temptations of studying masculinity and male behavior, men's behavior as men, rather than women's behavior, and that we would then never uncover what needed to be uncovered. She'd earlier, in her pioneering Black Women in White America, diverted larger questions of race by demonstrating that a history of Black women could be written. And here, as Thavolia told us, she had indeed developed an archive. By proving that there were sources available, she launched a generation of historians on new research agendas. In some sense, she did the same for gender history. Organizing her next book around women's culture, was called The Female Experience, she sought to demonstrate commonality among women, to find in their shared and quotidian experiences the sources of a collective consciousness and ultimately of women's liberation. But in 1970, I had come out of labor history. I had written a dissertation on the Jewish labor movement in New York in the 1890s, and I had systematically eliminated all the women from that dissertation because, after all, what did women in 1968 have to do with the labor movement? Or with work, for that matter. And in 1968, because I had conceived the labor movement as necessarily male, the motivating forces for social change in my dissertation had been differences in religion, in ethnicity, and above all, in class and culture. After I defended my dissertation in 68, I raised my head to discover the emerging women's movement. Embarrassed that I had systematically discarded the women who had been or should have been there, I began research on my first articles by searching for the women workers and trade unionists I had missed. I was, as you can imagine, acutely conscious of class. Already familiar with the work of the British historian E.P. Thompson, who changed the notion, transformed Marxist notions of class in the 1960s and changed the field of labor history. I was, like many other women of my generation, already involved in a Marxist feminist study group. There were a whole series of those in the first half of the 1970s, all scattered all over the East Coast. Now, this posed conceptual problems for somebody who wanted to become a historian of women, for if class and ethnicity and religion had constituted the analytic centers of my earlier questions, what was I going to do with gender? What role would it play? In that context, Gerda Lerner's The Lady and the Mill Girl, which forgotten who mentioned it. I think Linda mentioned it. Published in 1969, made an impact. I don't think I'd yet met Gerda when I first read that piece and resonated to the insight that among 19th century American women, those of the middle class could identify and call themselves ladies. Ladies were people who kept house with the benefit of household help and who had no need to earn their own keep. women of the poorer classes, even the middling poorer classes, the working classes, could only aspire to the perquisites of ladies. Only in the 20th century, around the issue of suffrage, Gerda concluded, would women of all kinds come together across racial and class boundaries. We know now, of course, that that didn't happen, that women didn't come together around racial and class boundaries in the early part of the 1900s. But even then, I was ready to ask of Gerda's essay, so what? So what does it mean if women call themselves, if some women can call themselves ladies and others are simply women? And sometimes not even women, sometimes they're wenches and have all kinds of other horrible names attached to them. What did it mean in terms of women's identity, in terms of their consciousness, in terms of practice, in terms of their expectations, the limits on their aspirations, the ways they might organize their lives, the ways they might vote? To my surprise, Gerda was hostile to these questions. She willingly entertained race as a sometimes divisive and often influential force in terms of women's relationships with each other. But as for many historians at that point, the search for commonalities obscured the significance of differences among women, and especially of class differences among them. They seemed so much less significant. And a moment when all of us were eager, all of us, historians of women, were eager to assert the prevalence of cross-class alliances, for example, among working women and middle-class women, when we wanted to acknowledge the presence of women in the peace movement and the significance of women's special mothering role in producing social settlements and a politics of municipal reform, few scholars wanted to ask how racial and class tensions among women influenced the political process. In 1974, when I went to Sarah Lawrence College, I was thus doubly guilty. I'd worked on a dissertation on Jewish labor history that had no women in it, and I was vested in notions of class as the primary analytic category to investigate. You may well ask, why did I go to Sarah Lawrence then? I had a perfectly good, I was even a tenured professor at that point at Hofstra, and why did I go to Sarah Lawrence? And the answer is, Gerda called up one day, this is literally true, and she said, look, I just signed a contract for the book that was to become Out to Work, A History of Wage-Earning Women in America. Gerda called up when she discovered I'd signed this contract, and she said, you're never going to be able to write that book. You know, too much class, she said, too many workers and not enough women. The only way you'll ever become a historian of women is to come to Sarah Lawrence and work with me. So I went to Sarah Lawrence to work with Gerda. What I learned from Gerda in the years I spent at Sarah Lawrence, I learned, you might say, against the grain, because as I said earlier, Gerda was then herself in the process of creating the field, of making those statements for which she is now so well known, those fierce defenses of what women's history could and should do. She and I both agreed that the sexual division of labor, everybody else agrees with this too, was among the first differentiations made by emerging civilizations. But the continuing differentiation among women and among men, embodied in the master-servant relationship, interested her less than the power dynamics within families. She was interested in questions of how women were subordinated in their particular positions, and how the common subordination would unite women together. So I set out to reveal that these were the micro emanations of macro processes that we had yet to understand. My own research and that of others quickly moved women's history into this larger sphere. We ended up knowing, understanding how gender and class, like race and class and gender, imbricated each other. We ended up by trying to understand the inseparability of these categories, understanding the function of that, but understanding that the function of all of them together, intersectionality, before anybody knew there was a word called intersectionality, provided a richer and fuller description of a historical process that would otherwise be inexplicable. I learned then that just as it mattered to a woman, whether she were white or black, native-born or immigrant, married or single, it mattered whether one earned one's own living or lived off the earnings of others, whether one worked as a drudge or a prostitute, or whether one could aspire to economic independence, whether one could barely support oneself on a woman's wage, or whether that wage could support aging parents or fatherless children, often siblings. These things mattered in the ways one built community or excluded from it. They mattered in the perception of opportunity and the material obstacles to social mobility. Gender mattered as well, and I had planned to give you a whole series of examples, but that red light is blinking. So let me give you just sort of two sort of summaries of the kinds of ways that it mattered. We learned through these experiences together, and I have to say that Gerda and I had many arguments and discussions about them until we came to agreement about them, that it was not simply the reproductive values of women that had to be understood, but that they had to be understood in the context of the class circumstances in which they existed. There was no such thing as gender without race. There was no such thing as gender without class. And from there, one could move on. The politics of the 20th century welfare state, as they have reshaped men's and women's roles, are fundamentally locked into that understanding. Awkwardly and slowly, we begin to contemplate how an ethnic and class-centered solidarity among immigrant women, for example, could move us towards an understanding of the ways in which tradition affirmed and negated gender roles simultaneously. One of the results is a huge change, not only among historians of women, but among all historians. And here I think Gerda's sort of insight that women's history could change not only the way we understand our past, and now the we is all of us understand our past, but that it could change the way we dealt with the future. So, for example, the emergence of the notion of a male breadwinner family, which we had all taken for granted in the old style women's history, has now become something that we not only question but locate in particular historical circumstances. We ask what its uses were, and we understand how it gets used both to create a welfare state and to undermine a welfare state. I could give you other examples, but I won't. I'll conclude simply by saying, so what? So what? So what did we do with women's history? We did exactly what Gerda had told us we should do. We started the process of changing the world. Thank you.